Good evening. Welcome to our International Laureates Organ Series recital tonight. And I welcome all of those here in person. I also welcome our online audience, wherever you may be. It's wonderful to have you with us tonight. I'm Jim Bonamani, the organist and music director here at St. James in the City. And before we begin, just a quick reminder for you to silence any phones and any other devices that make noise so that everyone can enjoy the concert without any distraction. Tonight we are delighted to welcome back Dr. Jeremy Filsell, the organist and master of the choir at St. Thomas Church, Fifth Avenue in New York City. You can read in your program all about the amazing background and talents of this versatile musician. He's equally acclaimed as a concert pianist, an organist, a recording artist, a conductor, a scholar, a singer, and much, much more, really. Those of you who are familiar with St. Thomas Church, Fifth Avenue, know that it is a pillar of Anglican liturgical music in the United States and really in the world. It's a true model of perfection for the art of church music and liturgy, a place that we all aspire to. It is with great honor, therefore, that we welcome Dr. Filsell as our artist this evening, and I ask you to please help me welcome him to the sanctuary.
That was a classic start. I've lost a page of music. I'm going to look for that page of music in a moment, but I thought since I've given you a taster of what you're about to hear, I'll tell you something the rest about the program before we commence, and I'll try and get the pages in the right order. You're going to hear, with luck, all of Pamela Decker's Toccata, The Resurrection. Pamela Decker is virtually a local composer, I suppose, being in Arizona, University of Arizona, professor of organ, and has been there for many years and has established quite a reputation as a composer. This piece, The Seven Last Words and Triumph of Christ, was written in 2018 as an AGO, American Guild of Organists commission. Very impressive series of works that I suppose finds its precedent in major works like the Le Chemin de la Croix, The Stations of the Cross by Marcel Dupré, and is based, of course, on The Seven Last Words. And then there's these final two movements that she writes, one of which is the Resurrection Toccata, which we're about to hear. I'm going to backtrack the second piece and play one of the other words from the cross. I think very beautiful, the vision of the mother at the foot of the cross, perhaps entirely appropriate for today being Mother's Day. But of course, in that situation, seeing her beloved son perish on the cross, But this is infused with the very beautiful plain chant Ave Maria, which you will hear in the pedals. I think it's a remarkable work deserves plenty of performances to come. Extending the plain chant idea, we're going to hear some Messiaen. And of course, Messiaen is probably one of the most controversial composers in some ways of the 20th century. Really used space and all kinds of elements, musical elements, in a collage way, whether it's birdsong or plain chant, or very aggressive, brutal dissonance at times. But he always based his music on a very strong and strident religious and spiritual sensibility. And the Méditations sur le mystère de la Sainte Trinité are no exception to that. This year, 2022, marks the 50th anniversary of the first performance of these pieces, which Messiaen himself gave in Washington, D.C. in March 1972. And it was my great privilege just a month or so ago to play the performance in D.C. that commemorated that premiere. They're remarkable works. They're not easy listening, I can warn you of that. But this, the sixth of the nine meditations, Dans le Verbe était la vie, et la vie était la lumière, is in the Word was life, and in the life was light. And this piece dwells very much in the world of plain chant, using various elements from the office for the Epiphany, the offertory, and the gradual Surge Illuminari, and the Alleluia from the Epiphany. And it's dressed up in a remarkable way, which uses space and very long chord sequences, and indeed silence. Very indicative of his unique art. Stephen Hough's Toccata. This is a quasi world premiere. Stephen is, as some of you may well know, one of the finest pianists currently in our musical world. A remarkable musician, a real Renaissance man, a writer, a composer, a pianist, and scholar. And his writing in recent years has certainly delved into the world of church music, and he's written some mass settings and a number of anthems, some of which I've had the privilege of programming at St. Thomas Fifth Avenue. He's been a great friend of St. Thomas in many ways, having lived between London and New York for many years, and he lives, when he's in New York, just around the corner, so he sometimes appears at Evensong and sits at the back incognito. But he's a wonderful musician, and he wrote this partita in 2019. It's a piano piece, and he said to me on one occasion, when he gave me a copy of this, and he said, this toccata, I had in my mind a French toccata, very much in the manner of Vienne or Vidor, but he's obviously a pianist, and so he wrote it for the piano, but he said, you know, I really ought to recast it, or get somebody to recast it as an organ piece. So of course that lit my imagination. So here we are, and this is my recreation of Stephen's toccata, piano toccata, as an organ piece. So I hope he will approve in due course. The real meat of the program is Evocation of Marcel Dupré. Now, Marcel Dupré was the teacher of Messiaen, so there's a connection there. And really, Messiaen developed the kind of language, the stylistic language, beyond that of Dupré. But Dupré was, for many years, both the organist of Saint-Sulpice in Paris and the organ professor at the Conservatoire. So many illustrious musicians passed through his tutelage. But he was therefore very influential, not just as a teacher, but because of his significant output for the organ. His organ music certainly reflects, again, a very sort of Renaissance approach to his music, and particularly perhaps his pianistic background. But I think his sense of drama and symphonic scale was unique in organ composition. And this piece dates from 1940-41. It was written during the war, therefore, and it was written in memory of his father, who died in 1940. So it was supposed to reflect some aspects of his father's character. Nonetheless, I think what it really reflects is some of the angst and some of the drama of wartime. And Dupré, living out at Meudon, in the hills of Meudon outside Paris at the time, was subject to the Germans putting an anti-aircraft gun on the top of his music room of his house because it was so high up in the hills. His wife Jeanette objected, but I think they moved the gun some way down the street. But I think that what you hear in a lot of this music is that aggressive gunfire. It's interesting that the very first theme, which is very cello-like, his mother was a cellist, has the germinal cell of music that becomes a gunfire motive in the last movement. It's a cyclic symphony, so all three movements have relationships. So there are themes in the first movement that are worth latching onto. There's a very lyrical one that appears quite early on in the first movement, which then becomes the triumphant, grandiose theme in the last movement. So it's a very strong symphonic thread to this music and very much reflects its wartime dramatic heritage. I think it's one of his most powerful compositions, and it's wonderful to play it here on a very dramatic organ. It is a great pleasure for me to be, of course, back at St. James. I have been honored to be asked two or three times back here, and it's always a joy to come back, and I thank Jim Bonomani for the invitation. And it's wonderful just to dip in on Evensong, which precedes this recital, and makes me feel like home from home. I hope you enjoy the concert. I will endeavor to get my pages in the right order, and we'll continue.